all here this morning. I'm certainly glad to be with you as we gather to praise and glorify our God. We just have the two announcements that are in the worship aid in regard to extra giving for this month. One is for our second mouth, which is the Baron J. Girls School Scholarship Fund. And the second one is paper towels for the food pantry. So if you'd like to contribute to either of those, it will be very much appreciated. You may have noticed that we've not been doing health updates since we've been back to worship, and that's primarily because of our time constraints. The battery for our camera only lasts about 45 minutes to an hour. So we have to get things done, you know, within that time frame. But I do have two special prayer requests to offer and ask you to be aware of. The first is Tim Wolf. Last week, Tim was in Cleveland Clinic getting some tests done in regard to his epilepsy. And he came through the test fine, is what I'm told, but they don't have an answer yet. He'll go back for that information with his doctors later this month. So please keep him in your prayers so that they can find answers to better help him with managing his epilepsy. The second prayer request came to me Friday. And it is Carly Stinson's second baby, right? His name is Marshall. He happens to be the great grandson of Carol Ann and Ernie Wolf, and the great nephew of Doug and Gale. But he is having some very serious health issues, and he's at Hannah in the NICU. And if things don't clear up, they will be sending him down to Pittsburgh Children's Hospital. So please send the prayers out for Marshall and his parents. Well, pray that he continues getting better. Yeah. And I know some of you got the prayer requests on the prayer chain. Others saw it on our private Facebook message group. But the more people praying, I feel it, the better off Marshall's going to be, as well as Carly. And what is the father's name?
Brandon.
Great. All right. So, all that being done, let us prepare our hearts for worship. Thank you. summers, our hearts can be burdened.
Stress and worry do not seem to take vacations.
We have come to a special place where we can find relief and healing.
Thanks be to God for providing us with such blessings.
Come, let us prepare our hearts to receive God's gracious gift of love.
We open our hearts and spirits in thanksgiving to God.
Glorious God, your
generosity waters the world with goodness, and you cover creation with abundance, awakening in us a hunger for food that satisfies both body and spirit, and with this food fill all the starving world. Amen.
Before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive right. recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting our trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, place your words upon my lips and in my heart, that I may proclaim your truth. Today, as we continue to work our way through Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, I was drawn, first of all, to verse 7 of this chapter, which is chapter 5, where it reads, "For we walk by faith, not by sight." As I reflected upon this text and read commentaries, it appeared to me that what Paul was saying and claiming is that this particular thing, walking by faith and not by sight, is the lifeblood of Christianity. There are two points that really stand out here. The first is Paul emphasizing the difference between seeing what is the outward appearance and seeing what is in the heart. For good or bad, Paul knows that what we see is not always what we get. And so, focusing on what is in the heart will not only get us further in our mission to spread the good news of God, but it is also safer for all. The second point is Paul makes a connection to sacrifice Paul reminds us not only of the sacrifice that Jesus made, but of our own dying to ourselves, because that's the only way that this mission is going to work, with sacrifice. That means giving something up. At verse 16, Paul really drives this home when he wrote, "We regard no one from a human point of view. We no longer view others as the world sees them." Even though it is our gut instinct to be defensive and to say, "But I'm only human. How else am I to see?" Yes, I know, and you know, and Paul knows, that we're not Jesus. We're not God. But neither was Paul. And yet, he urges us to see the world around us with new eyes. To stretch ourselves beyond our faulty clay jar humanity. Beyond the canvas of our tent, which we call our body. This gives us a radically fresh perspective on life. Life as a Christian. We no longer need to view others from the standpoint of human criteria. In the same way that we no longer view Jesus as just one more martyr for a righteous cause. In Christ, there is new creation. All that distorts in the systems and worlds that we have created for ourselves and others are now archaic. He wrote, "See, everything has become new." All this comes from God, who has reconciled us through Jesus and has not given us a special status to lord it over others or to be immune from life's suffering, but a ministry or a service of reconciliation. In Greek, the word we used was diakonia. Service of reconciliation. Serving others. This diakonia is grounded in the suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus. We have been entrusted with this diakonia, not to pass judgment upon others or to calculate their trespasses against them, but to share with everyone a message or a word of reconciliation that comes through us from God. How many of us like to be in charge? I see a couple of hands. Don't we enjoy being the boss? Being the one to whom others have to answer? Let's be honest. Even if it is just being in charge of ourselves, we take great pleasure in having that position. This is where living in faith or by faith becomes extremely challenging. Because we are told here by Paul that to properly function as a Christian, we are not in charge, but rather we are now ambassadors for Christ. That puts God in charge. And as followers of Christ, God needs to be in charge of us, of our actions, of our thoughts, of our words. We are to be instruments of God's words of consolation and reconciliation to the world. The same way that God offers us words of consolation and reconciliation. I don't know about you, but I have yet to see an instrument play without somebody programming it, turning it on, or otherwise playing it. We are God's instrument, and God is the musician, the master musician, turning us on, programming our hearts and playing us like a finely tuned instrument. For our sake, the one who knew no sin was made to be sin. Jesus took on all the ways we are hooked into abusive patterns with ourselves and with others, whether as victims or perpetrators, so that we might become the very righteousness of God, the very spaces where God's reign of mercy and consoling justice might overflow as grace, as free gift for all. In this way, we are a new creation. And that means we have a new set of eyes. And Paul is urging us to use them as they have been created to be used. It's the only way that true reconciliation within the world is going to happen, which is what this whole chapter is about anyway, right? Reconciliation. The reconciling of God's people to Christ. The reconciling of God's people to one another. The reconciling of God's people to the entire world. And the only way that can happen is if we use the eyes that God has fashioned for us through our baptism in the way that He has designed them to be used. As we go forth today in faith, let us walk confidently in the knowledge that we are ambassadors for God's love, consolation, and reconciliation to all we encounter. Let us trust that we do not live for ourselves, but for the one who died on the cross for our sinfulness. Let us see with new eyes that which is around us and respond to it through the eyes of God. And the people of God said,
Amen.
Thank you.
our harvest of sin to our God as we pray together. Lord of mercy and hope, we know
that we have all the children being the kind of disciples that you call us to be.
We have turned our backs on people in need. We have closed our ears to the cries of voices. Remind us of your mercy and how your love transforms and changes our lives. When we slide off the path of hope, you place foot for us. You pick us up and dust us off and put us again on the trail, confident of your faithful presence with us. Forgive our weakness, strengthen us and give us courage. Help us to be bearers of your good news of peace. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lift up your heart to give thanks to the Lord our God.
We gladly lift up our hearts to give God our praise and thanksgiving.
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, our Lord took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior gave us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Friends of Jesus, come to the table to see nourishment for your journey.
Thank you. body and pray in your name, God. Body and pray for you. Thank you. Amen.
Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. You take resources that appear to be meager, bless them, and there is enough. May your church trust that what you bless and ask us to share with the world is abundantly sufficient. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You offer yourself to all the nations and peoples of the earth, inviting everyone to abundant life. Bring the prophetic vision to fullness that all nations will run to you, and for those who do not know you, will find their joy in you. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You offer freely the fullness of salvation. Give Messiah such a welcoming heart that our words and actions may extend your free and abundant hospitality to all whom we encounter. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of compassion, we confess, repent, and reject the times when we as a church and as individuals have been silent in the face of racial injustice. Heal the hearts of those affected by racism in our community and worldwide. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Bring wholeness and healing to those who suffer in body, heart, soul, and mind, especially thinking of those on our prayer list and those we now name in your presence. Bless all who care for them. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You gathered your saints as one, united in the body of Jesus. Bring us with all your saints to the heavenly banquet. We remember those who have died, especially Myrna Wright, John Blackfoot, John Brooks, Charles Horn, Esther Kyle, and Gerald Anderson. We remember them with love and thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for peace in the world and for the safety of all military personnel, especially those who have congregational ties. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Give certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, O God. We offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. May God bless us and keep us in eternal love, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.